What's the scene, people? This is Matthew and
Summer
and
Ricardo.
And today we're gonna talk about. Yes, I just did that, and the Fight Club Blu-ray just topped over a little bit because we done talk about Fight Club. But we had to talk about. One of the best theme songs ever.
That's one thing I love about that, that whole letters crossing.
Yeah, channel. We're going to talk about that. Yes. So, of course, we're going to talk about James Cameron's The Terminator, right? Came out in 1984, changed the game.
I was going to say Hal and Anderson's
The Terminator. Yes.
Don't piss off Cameron.
Yeah. Guess who? He lose the case. So it's like, yeah. Well, sorry, you lost the case. It's not a dream, but you take it.
He said, up to now, he said he was forced. Because they told him, listen, if we take this to court and you lose, you will have to pay him. So he said, as far as he's concerned, this guy just got a free ride.
Okay.
Example, this is like a well-established
sci-fi writer. Right,
it's inspired by the works of the Satan at the very end of the movie, right?
That's right. He said he was forced to tack that on.
Yeah.
Listen, only Harlan Ellison and James Cameron knows his truth, right? So
yeah. All right, so without wasting any time, my history with The Terminator, right? So I did not see The Terminator when it came out in October. God, I was just born, right? Like about a month ago.
My parents used to carry me when I was young, but not when I was that young.
Right.
Yes. So back in 1991, when I was in primary school, a particular movie came out, and that movie was Terminator 2 Judgment Day.
Yes.
Mm. I will never forget how big a deal that movie was. Mm. It was big. Like, you saw the ads for this thing on TV. And I remember it being in theaters for all ages.
Yep.
Swear to God, it was for all ages.
So that was PG Terminator advisor. 1.
Yes, it was.
That PG advisor.
So was The Terminator.
Okay, so.
Oh my God.
Go ahead.
I remember that. Because the whole PG advice thing didn't come to like after like in the late 90s.
No,
right? That's
how old I am. Until what they did with that, I remember. Okay, so. Film people could probably tell me the real history of this. I'd go in and say, hey, guy who taught me once.
Right.
What's the history of this? I remember 18 years and over thing was after Terminator.
Okay.
Literally after Terminator. So I got the sense of people's like, oh shit, we can't do this unless it's like outright.
Right.
Thing.
Yeah.
Nobody, because it was like, that's when cinema became mass popular.
Right.
In the country.
I remember shots from it.
Yeah.
I always remember, you know, little Hamilton cocking that shotgun, that
blow,
right? I always remember, you know, Arnold flipping the shotgun.
Yeah.
Iconic moments, right? Yep. I love those, right? Him on the bike and all that kind of stuff, right? And then I can't remember if I saw, I think I saw Terminator 1 before 2, but I saw 1 on a little station. Yep. Well, AVM,
yep.
Channel 416. Yep. First time I ever saw that movie. Yeah. I didn't have cable back then, right?
Yeah.
Yes. Around 11 o'clock. Yes. Right. You remember that? Yes. I'll show you 11 o'clock. Swear to God, wrapped up close to 1 o'clock.
All right. So, some serious nostalgia dropping right now. Bombs. Yeah, is a nuke dropping.
Yeah.
On Sunday night, there was a little show called Super Force.
Yes. I used to watch that. Yes. And what I used to hate about the show? To be continued.
Yes.
Every single episode was a to be continued.
Right.
Why?
Right, but I remember that this kick-ass theme song.
I remember that same Sunday night, some friends was like, dog, Terminator showing tonight, Terminator showing. I'm like, how you know Terminator showing tonight?
Yeah.
And that is when...
Can you still advertise it on
12-4?
They had it in TV Guide.
Yes.
TV Guide first came out.
The TV Week for...
We had a local
TV Guide. And it was, you didn't have cable. This is when cable now came out.
Mm-hmm.
But I didn't get cable in a Rima because it took like about a year.
Yeah.
My cousins at Diego Martin had it.
Right.
Oh, by the way, you know what it is to be reading about movies that you can't even see, right? Like, this is how I got into movies. I was reading about movies that I never saw.
I used to take TV Guide. When I got cable, I used to take TV Guide to school.
Mm-hmm.
Just a scan to see shit that I knew I'd never seen. And the first time I see things like Storm Riders and all this obscure shit. Anyway, whatever. But that same thing, I remember watching Super Force ended.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, wait, a Sunday night, I have to get up for school, but I have to like time this smart. Yeah. I'll go and get up and watch Terminator. Because I had to go to sleep at 10.
Right.
Terminator started at 11.
Yeah.
I was like,
Yeah, I used to be that predicament. Plans. I used to go in my bed, have an alarm on, and then wake up, and then go downstairs and watch it.
The trick was how to turn on the TV.
Without your parents.
Right,
so,
but
the user
hears when you turn on, hear that.
Yes.
Because it's more category I had.
Yeah.
And then, but then, EVM, when you have a clear signal, because EVM had the shittier signal at the time.
Oh, yeah.
But EVM had it didn't have to make the noise, right? The static noise. So once you switch it to 4, there's tuk, tuk, tuk. And then turn, and then you used to turn it on without the noise.
Okay.
Boom. Pull off watching TV for the first time.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Right. So, as you see that, right, with EVM, this is where I learned about something called a mosaic filter. Mm-hmm. Because for the nude scenes in the film,
right,
you used to see this thing, and I was like,
this part.
Oh, okay, this is how we could get with showing stuff like that.
Yeah.
They still made little cuts here or there, I'll tell you where. But yeah, I saw it then, I was blown away. And then I remember one of my friends actually had Terminator 2 on VHS.
Yes.
Yes, that's how old I am, right?
Yeah.
Watching by him, loved it then.
Yeah.
I was like, okay, these are like two of my favorite movies. And then later on, the cinema that I frequently go to, Caribbean Cinemas 8, that's in Tricity. Mm-hmm. First movie that I ever saw there, that was in 2003, was Terminator 3, Rising Machines.
Okay. Right.
And I'll get to the subsequent films after T1 and T2, right?
Yeah.
But Summer, what's your history with Terminator 1 and to extent Terminator 2? Like how you got into those? Or what was the first time you saw those?
I might be dating myself here, but my parents took me to see Terminator in cinema with a bunch of other little kids.
Yeah.
And one of them screamed and freaked the hell out from the opening scene and we had to leave.
Right.
She would not stop crying. So after that,
the opening scene,
head is crushed by a foot,
skull, right.
That child screamed and
could not calm down.
Again, why were children in the cinema?
Yeah.
I don't know. But anyway, we couldn't watch it then. We went home. My dad got it on VHS for me.
Right.
So that's when I saw it. Mm-hmm. And for me, I always loved scary movies. And it was an action movie until it wasn't, you understand.
Yeah.
Until
the big reveal.
It's
hardly an action movie, you know.
It has some moments,
especially like when he got to the house and he fought the boyfriend.
I remember, it's so funny, everybody talks about the I'll be back police station moment.
That's elite.
And as a kid, line that I would go around the house saying was, Sarah Connor, yes? And then he kills the woman, and that stuck with me, I don't know why. So,
It's kind of horrific though.
It is, and the ending terrified me.
Yes, it is.
It's actually on Bravo, when it had Bravo TV,
right.
Bravo had this Bravo's top 100 scariest moments in cinema.
Right.
I have the entire thing downloaded and recorded because horror.
Right. Yeah,
and Terminator is actually the first one, number 100.
Wow.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's at that moment at the
but
end.
But it is appropriate because that scene is kind of terrifying.
It is, and just rewatching it now for this, I am just really impressed by how they did show don't tell with this movie. It works perfectly. This movie does not have that much dialogue, and I love it.
Yeah. All right. So after seeing Terminator back in the days of AVM, how did you get into like Terminator 2 and stuff?
Right. No. Yeah. Terminator 2 was my cousins loved that shit. He was like never shut up about it, and it was pretty cool. Like watching. I remember watching it on cable after.
Yeah.
I saw it on VHS as well. For the first time. Things that stand out with you is your mother's already dead.
Mm.
Awesome.
Yes.
Dog barking. Because when I saw that, I saw Terminator 2 before seeing Terminator 1.
Is that Wolfie barking?
Right, but Terminator could mask his voice and then get that in the first one. It's like, he could have done that in the first one.
Yes,
I forgot
he could have done that in the first one, you know.
Yeah.
And then the mother who is the girl from Aliens.
Yes, and I did not recognize her.
Oh, yes.
At the time, I did not recognize the actress.
The whole T-1000 thing is still to this day the coolest thing ever.
Absolutely.
That whole liquid metal.
Absolutely.
I mean, it still holds up. The tech works.
It does.
I mean, there's just so much of it is working so well. And then I actually like Ed Furlong That's the kid, too.
Yeah,
I
me,
got him.
Not so much.
Yeah, I dug him.
He
fed that whole early 90s
kid angst kind of
thing.
That's
your point.
Definitely that whole chip on your shoulder.
Yeah, that was perfect.
He fits it perfectly, but just for me, I've never felt like there's been a John Connor that I connect with as a hero.
Right.
With the exception of the Sarah Connor Chronicles.
Right.
But as you said, that character got time to
grow
out of the whininess and, you know, grow into the hero.
And then, just seeing stuff, just the whole, the T-1000 was so cool because like the opening big action sequence, he started running down.
Yes.
Yeah. Love that action.
He started running down. Yes. And he's like, wait, how you keep coming up with him on a...
Yes. And he's never breathing heavily, of course. And Robert Patrick was just perfectly cast.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I think he could do with his ears.
Yeah.
He could move his ears independently. So it's like, it made him seem so inhuman.
Yeah.
I just had this kind of... I don't know, this kind of like sneaky, this kind of
this
venomous
kind of
aspect about him.
Reptilian almost,
Like that's a nice
scene.
Bike.
Great.
Get out.
Love that. Love that. Especially reaction when the guy jumps up.
The thing is, one of the movies, the movie that you only in retrospect and knowing the history of the franchise, you realize, oh, this was the one that's the moneymaker.
Mm.
This is where they went on. Because it's effectively the same film.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
But they had, and at the time, like, I was always dumped on Terminator for selling out the plot, selling out the big twist.
Yeah.
This film did it.
Yes.
And I'll be the hero. Because that was the whole, he was the villain the first time. But because no one knew, or very few people knew about the first Terminator, it was not popular when it was out.
And Arnold was just such a big star already.
Right.
So he's like, hey, cool.
Right.
He's a hero.
Yeah.
Well, great.
Right. Right. And they had to market and sell that.
Yeah.
This was the toys.
Terminator 2 was supposed to be Terminator 1.
Right.
The story. And they just didn't have the budget. They didn't have it. And James Cameron didn't have the clout to get something like that made.
Yeah.
So they just said he did not drop the idea and we got Terminator 2.
Yeah.
So
and the first one just great bare bones.
It is.
Thriller film.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Right? And
it is.
You don't get what's going on until they hit the sci-fi conceit.
Yes.
Which they could have, much like with Predator, they kind of sell out early. Because they could have just made it a normal, like, oh shit, it's just this woman.
Yeah.
Right, then this is the bigger picture. Okay.
Not going to be a twist, but no, they we see a ball of energy appearing. So we know some sci-fi shit going on.
Right.
And then they hit you, what really going on, and explaining time travel. Again, as a kid, didn't get it because Star Trek wasn't in
my
head.
As a kid, too, it didn't occurred to me that he was a robot.
Right.
I just thought he was a big, strong guy.
Yeah, big, strong guy with a gun, right?
Yeah.
With a shotgun.
You know?
Yeah. But, yeah, about that. So, just kind of thinking about it, I think, like you, I saw Terminator 2 before Terminator 1. I just can't remember exactly what year EVM showed it, right? But I remember watching
EVM,
both movies
EVM
over when I finally got cable. Yeah. I remember WGN. Yeah, WGN, right?
Yeah.
Used to show Terminator 2 on repeat. I remember Sci-Fi showing Terminator 1. USA used to show it as well, too.
Right.
But over the years, I just grew to love Terminator 2. It is, in my opinion, the best action movie ever made. I stand by that word.
Right.
I stand by that statement. Yes. I love everything about it. The music, cinematography, T-1000, Robert Patrick, Linda Hamilton just being such an incredible badass. And that's just seeing the contrast from her in the first movie
to
this one.
And again, we never got that before. Never really got with, Ripley, but not to that degree.
Exactly.
So it was jarring in the best way.
Yeah. Which I would still say undermines Alien 3 and 4. Quite interesting. And she's all of a sudden, she's a big sweaty badass.
And that's just a testament both to what James Cameron did with Aliens, right? Because right after the first Terminator movie, he worked on Aliens, wrote and directed, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And turned Ellen Ripley into like this iconic,
badass.
She's not a badass
in that. She's just she's a kick-ass character.
Yeah.
Right.
But she's not... I didn't see her as a badass.
Okay, well, no, she's not
only
badass.
Until 3 and 4, they decided to do this...
And they clone her.
Right,
and
that
bullshit.
Yeah.
Especially
but,
4.
No, but,
like,
but that's essentially how she's just willing to stand up and just, defend Newt and, handle her shit, basically, right? But you just saw that in full detail with what they did with Sarah Connor.
Yeah.
And what I love is it's in part 1 as well, huh? That whole... Cause Kyle tells her, you are the mother of the future. And she's like, look at me. I can't even balance a checkbook. Do I look like the mother of the future?
Right.
Whatever.
Yeah.
But then we see those elements of where she's coming to terms with what is happening. And you see a woman that is you know, fighting back, and she's like on your feet, soldier, when Kyle was there. You know, so you're seeing, this person has potential to be a badass. It doesn't come out of left field.
What else about the, just a couple more things about 2D2, right? One thing I didn't pick up on until like after the fact that the movie was set like 10 years after the first movie, because like technically 94, 95, because I don't want to assume that John is 10 years old.
It's supposed to be, but it's wrong.
It kind of looks like 12, 13.
Because apparently Sarah Connor is supposed to be 18 in the first movie.
And
she conceived him, she turned 19, and then when they have that scene where the Terminator looks at the computer to get his address.
Right, that's what it's saying. People point that out.
It's off. It's saying that, you know, so he's supposed to be 10, but the character's 13.
Right. Yeah, it's one of those things you don't really pick up on until like after you see it.
Yeah.
But I just love everything about this movie, and I love just how slick and polished everything looks compared to like the first one. Yeah. There's this kind of silverish kind of aesthetic to it. Yeah. I think this looks so clean and polished. And I admit, the last scene in the movie, it's bring out my auntie out to murder.
Yeah.
Like that moment where he says, "Now I know why you cry," but it's something I can't do.
Good luck.
I love that shit.
And they avoided the, okay, so one of the original endings with the fans, test audiences hated that. Well, test audience.
Right.
They hated, which is...
Oh, with Sarah being old.
Yeah, they showed the future.
Yeah.
And how it was a nice future, and John ended up being a doctor.
That's in the... Right, so there's extended cut of it. There's extended cut of the movie, right? You could get on DVD or Blu-ray. And they show that as that scene.
I remember seeing it on cable, and I was like, wow, this wouldn't work at all.
Yeah.
People are here, this.
Yeah. But I do love how the theatrical cut ends with the road, and where she says, you know, if one machine could understand the importance of, you know, the world, then maybe we can too.
Yeah.
Brilliant way to end this off. So I totally love that movie, right?
Right.
So Terminator 3. Let's run it through the franchise quickly, right? Well, of course, we had the video games, you know, we had the highly popular Terminator 2 Judgment Day game, you know what I mean?
I had T2 for the SN, the NES. Loved it. Although when I go back and play it, total nonsense. The game is one of the worst games ever. Really badly designed. Don't make sense.
Right, okay.
Whatever.
Yeah. I remember it in the arcades.
Yeah. I used to play the arcade when you shoot them up.
Yeah.
Right. So Terminator 3 comes around, and here's the thing. I don't hate this movie as much as people do. It's really a waste of opportunity, right?
Right.
Because for me, it just felt like, okay, it's 2003. Okay, you're trying to subvert some stuff. It's like, okay, well, some of these stuff in Terminator 2 is dated. I get that. So let me update it. So let me have Arnold have these hack glasses. Ha, ha, ha. That's funny, right? Mm-hmm. Have Arnold say, talk to the hand. Yeah. That's funny, right?
Right.
Yeah. Not really, right? John didn't really come off as a compelling hero.
Yeah.
Claire Danes wasn't.
I think John is miscast, but Claire Danes worked for me.
Yeah, well, I mean, Nick Stahl is fine, but he's just standout.
So the Claire Danes character is supposed to be the central character, actually. Not him.
But
because, again, in your head, the franchise market in such a way.
Mm.
Oh, John Connor is the hero of the future.
Yeah.
Right. And it's not really. So we didn't talk about the probably most controversial thing about the first film, which is the whole time loop stuff.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, we'll talk time stuff. Right. Yeah.
But, right, so that aspect of how important is John Connor? Because if time travel keeps changing him every time, and he have quote-unquote different fathers, that's a whole argument, because people have, like, the real simple explanations behind that. But that film, because you miss the focus of it, it doesn't work for you. Same problem, exact same problem with the next film as well. With 4. But, yeah, go ahead.
Right. Yeah, so the villain, Christina Loken.
Yeah.
She had to look down.
Right.
Her powers, her skill sets are like for the most part.
Right.
Even though the whole hacking into machines thing is kind of silly.
The idea was to have her be the best of both.
Yeah.
200 and 200. Yes. But you get kind of the worst of both.
When she does stoic though, when she has to have a straight face, especially like when she clicking punches,
right,
it just looks kind of off. Right. But I get where this is coming from. But what I especially love about the movie, two things. The opening and closing scenes. Like I just love... Right. You know, where it's like, you know, the future's not set. There's no fate for what we make for ourselves. And you see that missile drop and that big explosion.
Right.
I love that, right? Now, one thing, though, I'll bring it up later on with the movie here. This whole, there's no fate but what we make for ourselves. That was never mentioned in the first movie, you know.
Right.
In the second one,
make it.
That's when they bring it. This whole no fate but what we make thing that John was saying. And then
it
just become part of pop culture where it's like, oh, this is everything that Kyle said to Sarah in the first movie.
No, but he does, you know, in the tunnel,
Right, I know that. I know that.
There's a message from John.
Right, and now it was basically him saying.
The last part of the message is something along the line. It's not exactly. There's no faith, but what we make. It's
right.
Not
no, but
exactly
he says
that.
The future is not set. But right. They say, I don't know. I don't know what to tell you about the, you know, the dark days, blah blah blah. But I want you to be strong, blah blah blah. Mm-hmm. The future is not set. I didn't hear there's no faith but what we make for ourselves.
No, it was.
That just
it
pops
was,
up in the second one and everybody assumes this is what Kyle said in the first one. It's like, no, he didn't say that. Yeah.
It's
just weird.
No, it's a variation of those, what he said.
Is the whole, look, I'm your father.
Yeah.
Right.
Beam me up, stop. Yes. Scotty. It's that. It's people just misremembering a quote and just filling in the space. Well,
yeah. Yes. So, opening scene I particularly love. Couple of the action scenes in Teacher, like I said from a Bad Boys review.
Right.
I thought that the chase scene for that, the chase sequence was probably one of the best
with
of the
yes,
with the truck
and
yeah.
Yeah, I thought that was good.
Yeah.
Because they built a building first and they mash up the building.
Yeah. I also love the fact that there was no music until like the last few seconds of it.
Yeah. Mm.
Last like 50 seconds, that's when you hear the music. Yeah. That was cool. But the ending though, I particularly loved. Okay. I know this is like a controversial thing, but I love the aspect that Judgment Day is inevitable.
Right.
You know, we've been trying to stop it.
Well,
so it makes sense logically to not end the movie like, oh, we averted Judgment Day again. Haha.
Yeah.
No, you had to kind of let it happen. And the way how it happens, like, well, yeah, it makes sense.
Right. I guess you can
and
argue
it just
kind
of sets up, oh, well, okay.
The time travel is causing it,
right.
In a sense.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, and I did take it, okay, so damn it, 4-1 got me hard now.
Yeah.
So then Terminator Salvation drop, I was like, not really.
This was another example of weird marketing. Because here's the thing, this came out right off of Dark Knight.
Yes.
So in your head, Christian Bale playing John Connor. Why?
Yeah.
And I'm watching the movie and being so confused by it. I'm like, why this like this? Why?
Christian Bale.
Like, I'm watching it and I was like, it frame weird. And I think, and then it take me like literally like hours upon hours after the film. It's only like that night.
Yeah.
I was sitting there, I was like, wait. John Connor's not the start of the story.
No, he's not.
Thank you. Yeah. He's not.
That was so weird. I would say misleading. It's like, just because the Dark Knight was so popular, you know, Christian Bale was like the biggest star in the world at the time.
Yeah.
They use him to market.
They have
him
playing the main franchise, you know, figure.
Yeah.
So it had you in your head thinking, well, he's going to be the star.
Yeah.
He's not the star of the story.
And once again, we get a John Connor that I feel is a waste.
Right.
I've never got a John Connor that's impressed me.
Well, you know, rest in peace, Anthony Yelchin.
Yes. Who played Kyle Reese? Young Kyle Reese.
I thought that was good, and he was like a star of the story. And then
here's the problem with Kyle Reese here. They set up this whole thing that Skynet have a kill list, and the guy on top of the list is Kyle Reese.
Mm-hmm.
So they never really say in the movie because I watch it over. They never say in the movie why they want to kill him off, you know.
Right.
It's only later on it's like, oh well, he's the one who goes back now.
Right.
So it's just like John have to protect him because
that's a problem. Because two major problems with the film.
Right.
Let us admit it. Nobody actually cares about the war.
No.
That's an important part of the Terminator franchise.
Right.
The whole point is we're fighting the war now.
Yeah.
Because the time travel thing. So using future shit and you had to use current weapons to fight super robot.
Yeah.
Right.
That is the only thing that make that interesting.
But
the first film interesting, it makes the second film interesting.
Yes.
But the problem with Salvation, sorry to cut you, the problem with Salvation is that it's before 2029.
Right, we know that. It's
2018 actually.
Right.
So they're using automatic weapons on these machines. They're like, this is kind of boring. They're like,
exactly.
What are the lasers, yo? Like,
exactly.
We saw that in the first second movie.
They started to get some kind of thing.
Yeah. At least Genesis, show it.
But we'll
get to that too.
And there's another problem is that because they don't care about the future war, they're trying to do all this world building in it.
Yeah.
The leader of the future is in sub. Because they had leaders before John Connor.
Yes.
And that's like,
Nobody cares.
Yeah.
I don't know.
But here's the real reason why. Yeah? Because the first two.
The most famous thing about that film is Christian Bale having a meltdown over a gaffer.
Yeah. Right. I don't know. Like looking at Christian Bale in it, it's almost like he doesn't want to be there. He could see it in his face. Just like, dude, what am I doing
That's
this
why
shit?
I
why am I doing
actually
this?
Liked the initial idea they had and that they were, like, apparently either it didn't test well or they decided that people wouldn't like
this. The idea was to have this lead, have a new trilogy.
Yes.
Where this leads to the time travel going back.
Yes.
Right.
That still won't work. Because that would just be a waste of goddamn time. If Salvation was entirely... like a time thing, and they just say, okay, we're gonna move from 2018 to 2029.
Right.
And the movie ends with Kyle's leaving.
Yes.
It could have kind of worked.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Maybe. But they decided, no, we're going to stretch this out.
Yeah.
And you need to know about the war. And yeah. No one cares. And another problem is that they have one of the worst directors to pick for that. McGee.
McGee of all people?
Yeah. McGee, what?
The director of Charlie's Angels. Yeah, Charlie's and Charlie's Angels Full Throttle.
And not to mention, Sam Worthington is so overrated.
No, he's flat.
Yes. And the funny thing is, this come out the same year as Avatar. I guys watch this like,
no,
wow.
The
irony in this.
Bland
the
as
irony
a cracker with yeah. no cheese.
No, no,
he's
no.
Just,
Sam Worthington is like, you know, Australia, you're not sending your best. Yeah. I always say that. He and the next one who I do like.
Oh, okay. Jai Courtney. Which you're going
to get? Jai Courtney? Yeah.
No, but
where did Charlie Hunnam come from? Jake, or he's British?
Who's that?
Charlie Hunnam. Where you come from?
Hunnam is...
No, Australian too.
I think
I have
British
no beef with the man because I watch Sons of Anarchy. I love that
I
show.
I love
so.
Charlie Hunnam. I am not ill-speaking Charlie Hunnam at all. But
I mean, King Arthur was...
I would King Arthur nonsense. I like City as you. So,
and I have a girlfriend who worships... Like, I have girlfriends who think Jai Courtney is everything.
Right. Right.
For me, he's just, whatever.
Yeah.
But yeah, Sam Worthington is good.
No, yeah. what kill he was with for me was that... Clash of the Titans foolishness.
Well, here's the thing.
Why are you gonna bring this up?
What pissed me off in Clash of the Titans is apparently Sam Worthington hated Bobo.
Okay.
The owl. And I'm like, listen, I was a huge fan of my claymation, Clash of the Titans. Don't disrespect Bobo.
They bring in Bobo as a cameo, like a brief cameo. I'm like, what?
He said he would only be in the movie if he's allowed to throw it away or destroy it. I'm like, screw you, Sam Worthington.
Nah,
disrespectful. That's why your career gone.
Yeah, disrespectful.
Because you're disrespectful.
Yeah, but back to Salvation, right? So the thing that really killed it for me, I was wondering to myself, this is not working. Why? You have Christian Bale, you have all these people, right?
Common.
Yeah, you have Common in it, right? Who just have like these really generic ass lines.
Oh my God, it was terrible.
Oh my God. Like, respect to Common, but don't watch them lines.
Terrible.
Is that at the end of the day, people want to see Terminators, right? We don't care about
the
humans and the resistance and
the
blah, 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 blah.
All right, so the big thing at the end was, okay, they do that's the first time we get to see young Arnold.
Yeah, that was kind of cool. That was kind of cool.
With
the audience, I saw it. Europe, when they saw it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. No, they liked it smart. They got a secret to that. Eh?
Yeah.
This is before deepfakes.
Right.
Yes.
And this is when they had to do the CG stuff.
Yeah.
And I thought they liked it intelligently. Mm-hmm. It was framed smart intelligently. It's like, all right, you had to fight a T-800 for the first time. That was a big thing.
Yes.
And T-800 was the logical step from...
The model.
Was the big twist at Sam Worthington? Yes. Which is another thing they sell out in the trailer.
I was about to say that too.
Right.
Yeah,
the trailer
just,
whatever.
Oh my God.
Yeah. And yeah, it Salvation just didn't work.
It didn't.
As I said, the thing with McGee is that McGee is, this is a sad thing to say, but he's a bad Michael Bay. He's Michael Bay like.
That's true.
Like, at least Michael Bay know how to do the explosions.
Yeah.
Right? But the lazy explosions, a lot of the action sequences don't work.
Yeah.
And there's something about the aesthetic of it. It looks kind of drained out.
Yeah.
Like there's
no color to it, but
at the same time, it just makes it feel kind of like, it just does something on the eyes. It looks ugly to watch.
It's lazy.
That whole washing color out of stuff to make it seem more gritty pisses me off.
Very few people, here's the problem. People don't know how to use that. Right? So here's how not to use it. Man of Steel. Here's how.
Oh my God! Yes.
Here's how to use it. Bridge of Spies.
Okay.
You had to know how to apply your drabby color stuff. Now.
Yeah.
They didn't get out to Aldred. You miss it. And he's like, he's just a really bad director for this.
Yeah. However. Right. So Salvation came and went, and then we got Genesis in 2015.
Right.
And this is funny because this is the first, one of two shows that we covered.
Right.
The first episode of our BSB to be the podcast. Right. At the time, I didn't really care for it that much. I think I gave it like a 2.5 out of 5.
Yeah, hated it.
Yeah. But watching it now, and bear with me here, right? Theoretically, this is a term that they use a lot in the movie. In terms of subverting what you expect, in terms of like a soft reboot, in terms of like a remake kinda, it works.
Yeah.
Because literally everything that you come to expect, like let me not talk about the trailers yet, right?
Okay.
If you just went in blind, knowing what you know about T1 and T2, you're like, oh shit, so they're doing this, but they flip this. Okay, this is working. All right, cool.
Yeah.
The thing with John, okay, this all making sense. I even like the beginning, too, where you see the war and you see like what happened before the Titan displacement, you know, you did all that kind of stuff. It's like, okay, this making sense.
Yeah.
But then on the flip side to it, now it's like, but you're not really bringing anything new to the table.
Right.
This is just the same T1, T2 stuff all over again. Judgment Day all over again.
Yeah.
everything that you see me for again. So it doesn't really bring anything new and fresh there. So then at the end of the day, you're like wondering, well, why does this movie exist?
Yeah,
like,
no, as I said before,
I don't know.
It's a classic case of what you call 10 pounds of shit in a 5-pound bag.
Hmm.
Right.
No way you could have fit those ideas in 2 hours.
Yeah, there's so much great ideas and you want to compress it to 2 hours.
Yeah. We had to talk about, well, my relatively recent favorite in the franchise is Sarah Connor Chronicles.
Mm. Yes. How can we forget that? Yeah.
Solid series. Mm.
Lena Headey.
Which is funny though, because both Lena Headey and Emilia Clarke from Game of Thrones play Sarah Connor.
Right. You know, solid world building. They get that girl to come up for Firefly.
Yes.
Forgot
Summer the name. Something.
Summer Glow.
Good show. Like, logically it work.
Yeah.
They do good enough twists. So they jump to the future.
Yes.
Right, and it's post 9/11, and like, oh, this thing happened, so the real world shit going down.
Yeah.
But then they say, oh no, she had still stopped the Terminator stuff. And they focus everything on Sarah Connor.
Yes.
Logically, everything works and makes sense. And then they establish something that I thought was so brilliant. Because they answer a question. All the nerd shit questions that they had a problem with, the answer. The answer, well, how exactly John Father, the whole John Father thing, who's the real John Father?
Right.
Apparently, it's a really simple, super simple question. She was pregnant from before.
It's an
unknown guy. Kyle Reese is not the father. No time loopy.
So maybe it was the guy who called to cancel the date on the phone.
Boom.
I love that. Yeah.
Simple question.
Yeah. I never thought of that. Thank you. You saved my headache.
Yeah, it's a simple headcanon.
Kyle Reese's time loop thing always threw me for.
Forget that.
Yeah. We're talking about
the show addresses all of these little small things. And here what they address. They address one of the big ones, which is not only time looping, but why exactly is John Connor important? They answer that by saying, look, one, most timelines, he's not that important.
Okay.
And it plays out without him.
Right.
Okay. Without him. That could happen. Because the way how they imply anything. And then they imply something I totally love and make perfect sense. Well, if this Skynet thing's so smart, how come the humans outsmarting it? The answer is, they're not outsmarting it. In one of the timelines, there's a good Skynet out there for some reason. That is so cool and interesting.
I need to watch the show.
You can rewatch it.
Here's the thing. Right when they started to do these interesting implications, they canceled.
After two seasons, bro, like, what's going on, Fox?
It was Fox, right?
Yeah.
My thing with Genesis is that Genesis was back, that is when Netflix was now taking off, now getting hot.
Yeah.
To me, they didn't need to put that in theaters. If they did take that, say, like, stretches out to about six to eight episodes and flesh out that story,
it'll
blow up and do gangbusters.
Yeah, in retrospect, it makes sense.
It's only now so people respecting Netflix. Yeah. Like, they could have done that then.
Yeah. Yes.
But no, we have to chip this up and put this in rush.
Yeah.
Right, and then the worst part about it, too, and you saw this with the theatrical cut of Salvation, PG-13.
Yeah.
I mean, it really brought it up.
Very fascinated by the whole Sarah was raised by one of these things. And give me a movie of that.
Yeah.
Honestly.
And the whole, that's what I like about it. It did the whole loop in a loop stuff.
Yeah. Because then it makes sense that, okay, we're going to go even further back.
Yeah.
A machine would be like logically thinking, no, well, let's go further back. As you say, a good Skynet would say, she needs to know how to protect herself.
That's the thing. It's not just humans versus machines.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
If it was just humans and machines, we'd all lose.
Yes.
So how come Skynet, the type of version of Skynet are good? What happened there? What going on this?
Yeah.
Then they cancel the show. But whatever.
Yeah.
But no, that's when
it's like Dark Matter.
So you know
people. Oh, yeah.
As soon as they introduce, hey, you know what? There's aliens. Really? Dark Matter gets cancelled. Like, seriously?
Listen, I know people jump for the Stargate universe.
Oh my god.
Stargate universe.
Yeah.
They find a pattern in the universe implying the universe is designed.
Cancel.
Such a great idea.
Yeah.
However.
But Summer, what's quick thoughts on Genesis before we jump into this one here?
I did not understand what all the hate was about, but for me, I was one of those people that ranted at that trailer spoiling that John Connor thing. It's a bunch of good ideas that is too much, you know, in too short a space of time. But it's good ideas. Yeah. So if I had never seen that trailer and that John Connor reveal had happened,
that'd be great.
I would have been blown away by that.
Yeah.
Right? I don't understand the hate for Emilia Clarke or Sarah O'Connor.
No, she was fine.
She was fine. If you see Linda Hamilton in Terminator 1, it's basically on par with the 1-2 acting of that.
Yeah. Jai Courtney, however,
Courtney is replaceable in that role.
He should have been a Terminator, right? He should have been one.
And I didn't really feel any chemistry between them. They're supposed to have chemistry and it's not really there.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, the only jokey stuff part is the fact that she's like 5 feet tall and he's like 6'2". You know, but...
And I actually thought Annie was great.
Annie has been like, I mean...
As the old grizzled to the turn, I like
that. Came back after being the governor of California.
Yeah, right.
And then he hit me with Maggie. And he hit me with all his stuff. And he stole the show in Escape Plan, you know. The only one worth seeing, the first one.
Yeah.
And he's just been knocking them out of the park, in my opinion.
I
like old Annie.
Right. The thing is that... I'll talk about a very disturbing piece of trivia. Although we know it already.
Okay.
With Terminator 1. But when we get to Terminator 1.
Right.
And, another thing is that they did the young Arnold thing again.
Yeah.
Replicating the shots.
Yeah. I loved it.
The Next Nightfall thing of Bill Paxton was
there. Yeah, they bring back everything. It's like, appreciating this. But it's not bad nostalgia,
because
it's serving a purpose and they support everything back. Yeah. And then she used the sniper rifle thing to smoke to take on the T-800.
Yeah.
So I like this.
Yeah.
Then the movie just
unraveled.
It's just
insane.
But everything, everything after the kill off the T-1000 with the acid thing.
Yes.
But I like that. That whole things that mash up or subvert metal. And our liquid level, that's the way to deal it. So, last time it was the liquid metal lava stuff. This time it's acid.
Yeah.
I like that. And they have all these little quick tricks they know how to deal with these things.
Yeah.
And then everything after that.
And
they just went to 2015 because now Skynet is an app called Genesis. But I'll talk about the whole time thing.
So, there's one thing with Terminator we'll talk about. You have the failed technology. Right. The fair technology and how to, the problem is that don't adapt to now. Back in the time of Terminator, the Cold War.
Yeah.
The Cold War, the idea that things would just go wrong and we could just nuke ourselves easily. And it had genuine significant risk that was happening back when the Cold War was on.
Mm-hmm.
So the idea of, we could just tie everything to one AI and the AI would just like be good for us. And it'll just straight up brainiac us now.
Yes.
Yeah.
I like that. Right? Yeah, it's still doing the fair technology stuff, but it makes some sense because it's not so much fair technology, it's the fair big government, big systems, bureaucracies, why these horrible decisions being made because no one person makes it. It's the failure of a whole cacophony of bad decisions, right?
Right.
It'll work whereby saying, oh, there's an app.
Exactly.
We're trying to say that Facebook shitty for you.
Right,
the big bad evil app is gonna take over the world, guys.
But I was like, all right, maybe Facebook shitty for us, but that's not the way it's gonna be shitty for us. Yeah. It's more to do with shitty news and Russians.
Fake news and all this kind of stuff.
I'll admit if that movie came out in 2016 and you see how shitty that could play out, I can imagine them modifying the script to have it make a little more sense.
Mm.
Right.
Maybe. Right, it's Skynet could fuck up Facebook and have people think and cause this and maybe
misinformation and all this sort of thing. Yeah.
But at the same time, it's like no, but the war as we understand it can't play out like that.
Yes,
exactly. We don't know because you don't know what weather.
Yeah,
the script don't work, it don't flow.
Yeah,
it's a shame actually.
Yeah. Right, so let me just get back to where it all started, man. The first Terminator movie. Which of course opens up with the intro, opens up with the intro, right?
Yeah.
Where you see the future, LA 2029, you're seeing, it's James Cameron and you're seeing his beginnings, involving special effects. So you know it have rear projection, it have matte stuff and things going on, right?
Like it got some.
Yeah, but it just looks so seamless as well, too.
Yeah, motion animation. It actually holds up pretty decently,
You can look at it and be like, I know this is a shot here and this background. Right? But what I like, though, is just the world that it starts with, right? So dismal and dreary, and you see a bunch of skulls on the ground.
Yeah.
Like, just skulls on the ground, some crazy shit, right? I like this interesting from the text, right? Yes, I have suffered it now. Where they say, the machines, their war to exterminate mankind has raged for decades, right?
Right.
And then, the nuclear fire and the final battle will be fought in the future, but in the present. I just love the last word tonight. Yeah. Dot, right. dot dot dot, right?
Right.
And then we get the iconic title for the Terminator. You know, I love just how the words kind of slide in. Yeah. Of course, you see its influence now with Stranger Things.
Yep.
And even the music, the kind of synth-heavy music is very, you know, you see that with Stranger Things.
And of course, we get that iconic...
That theme song still holds up, in my opinion.
Yep.
Even though, personally, I thought that the T2 version of it...
Of course, They just armed everything
up. It sounds louder. It sounds more impactful. Yes,
this was a destroyer of desk in high school.
Ah, yes.
Between that and clips grinding, are your two songs? Between that and clips grinding, destroyer of desk.
Yeah, and the composer for this, the great Brad Fiedel.
Yeah.
Yeah, he just killed it with the music. Yeah. I mean, the second one had a great score for it. It was just really intense.
Yeah.
But this one was like real heavy on synth because I remember it's 1984, right?
And that, too, this is sure is how much work did Dan O'Bannon do on this film?
Did Dan O'Bannon work on this? I know his name with Alien. Everything Alien is with him.
I didn't was thinking Dan O'Bannon did work with it.
Right, and well, on the subject of that, they call it special Terminator effects, were done by the late great Stan Winston, who also worked on Alien, Alien, sorry, also worked on Iron Man as well, too. You know what I mean? That's a show. So, Arnold's entrance to this is just so incredibly iconic.
Yeah.
I just love the beginning of it, though. That's how it's all set up, and they replicated, of course, in Genesis. The black guy by the construction site, whatever it is.
Yeah.
And he's like, "What the hell?"
Yeah.
God damn son of a bitch.
Yeah.
And you just see the lightning spark. He's like, "What the hell?" Man, jump out. And then, like, you get like I'm gonna call this the T-101 team. The dun 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 dun.
Yeah.
Just him on the ground there, just kind of cool up, and he's naked.
Right.
So iconic.
Yeah.
When he lifts up, iconic.
Yep.
And then, of course, when he walks.
In his prime,
yes,
so
when he walks, and then
coming
when
off of Conan.
Right. Which I love the first Conan movie. I stand by that.
Okay.
First Conan the Barbarian movie, masterpiece. As far as B movies go, masterpiece.
Okay.
I love
Piece of disturbing trivia.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. Was supposed to play Terminator originally?
Oh, Jesus.
Yes. Yeah. And they say, here's why you can play him, because he's too nice of a guy. Wow.
Irony.
Imagine OJ Simpson playing Tony.
Oh, my God.
No, but the whole too nice of a guy thing.
Too nice of a guy thing is the funny part of it.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
But I was going to say, it's like when I saw it on EVM, mosaic filter.
Yes.
Okay, I was like, that's what they're doing. All right, cool. Yeah. I could watch this and pretty much see everything,
rewatching that, I was like, oh my goodness, I can see little Arnold. Yeah. I did not realize you could see that in his shot.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, they darkened it out when we saw it.
So, yeah. Because, in the subsequent shot, with the punks, right?
Yes.
One of them played by the late great Bill Paxton.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Game over, man.
Yeah.
Game over. Right.
And Shao Kahn. With the guy with the very rugged face, the
actor.
The one who gets his heart removed.
Okay, it's them. Okay. I forget.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. So yes, as you said, when he's walking, you could see little Arnold. I'm like, wow, they actually get rid of that.
Yeah.
Different
the lighting.
Yeah.
All that love how in Genesis they kind of cover it up enough for you to. Right. And you know, see lines from it just so iconic for me. Yeah, I'm going to be using new word iconic a lot. Yeah, I'm a Gene Smith's shit right now, right?
Right.
So, nice night for a walk, eh?
Mm.
Nice night for a walk. Wash day, right?
I love that
Nothing
part.
Clean,
Nothing
right?
Nothing clean is in it.
Yeah.
I just love
clean,
that.
Nothing clean, right? This guy, what is my bear short of a six pack, whatever it is? He's like, your clothes. Give them to me now. He's like, fuck you, asshole.
Mm.
And then, of course,
it's 80s, so you get your switch blades.
Right. And this, you know, cutting-wise, I love the cutting. Like, it shows the act of violence, but it shows it for a second when his hand goes through his chest, and then when you just see his hand come out, his arm comes, so it's all covered in blood.
Yeah.
So I love that, right? Next character shows up is Kyle Reese.
Yeah.
He shows up
by the late Michael Biehn.
Michael Biehn.
Rest in peace to him. Who also, which I learned, after the fact, wasn't initially going to be in Aliens, you know.
Okay.
Yeah. Like, they were going over Aliens. It's like, but wait there. But James, how come here? Yeah, come on, what's going on?
Right.
So they worked it out. It's like, all right, cool. We'll be okay.
And some trivia here for you, too. He's like, he nearly didn't get the role because he had been doing some theatrical training, voice training for Cat on a Hot Tin Roof.
Okay.
And he had a southern accent that he needed to drop.
Right.
So they gave him a month. Okay. And then he came back.
Right.
And Arnold was supposed to be Kyle Reese.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's I can't picture it. Imagine at see that. All,
what day is this?
Yeah.
What year?
Yeah. And James, a lot of props to James because he had no power back then. Right. And he had to fight the studio a lot because they were like, we don't want this guy. It's like, no, the Kyle Reese I picture is a much skinnier guy, much smaller guy. And then he didn't want Arnold. Right. He said they went to meet him for lunch.
Right.
And James said he had every intention of picking a fight with him, so he'd have an excuse not to pick him.
Right.
And Arnold came with such good ideas for the character that he was like, okay, I think I know who I want you to play. You know, it's not going to be Kyle Reese. This is who you're going to be. You know, so everything worked out.
Yeah. Michael Biehn's the inspiration for Solid Snake as well. You know,
he is?
What?
Yes.
Awesome. Yeah.
Look up the original... look up the original cover for Metal Gear.
Okay.
It's a pretty much the same shot from Terminator.
All right.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah, Michael plays Kyle Reese. You know, he's a resistance soldier sent to 1984 to track down and destroy the Terminator and, of course, protect Sarah Connor, who we're going to see in a little bit, right? I love where the police chase him down. He goes into this shopping mall.
That chase is awesome.
Yeah, and just the music that they do, very synth-heavy, but it just sets him.
I forget if this was a big thing, but was this an outright Nike reference?
Yes. Yeah, Nike Vandals. Nike Vandals.
I'm like, dude, it's like, you have any idea how much those are worth now? Those are thousands of dollars.
I want a pair, damn it. I want one.
They're very short.
I love it.
Pass
and
just come.
I'm here. Pull that.
Yeah.
But what I love too is the whole show don't tell that's going on in those first few minutes.
Yes.
From what happened with Arnold to Kyle in that chase, us seeing what I'm looking for.
Power dynamic.
Yes.
Immediate and, power dynamic. He come back here undercut from local authorities while Arnold just tears up.
But he's also very good, quick on his feet in terms of thinking,
totally different power dynamic.
I need to get close, I need to get there, I need to get moving, I need to get wheels. Mm-hmm. And it's just, I just loved it.
Mm-hmm. Right, and I thought it made sense for both Arnold and, both the Terminator and Kyle to go in to go look for a phone book,
right?
So they're looking first for Sarah Connor, right?
Right.
And you see in chilling detail how the Terminator processes that, like, oh, well, all these Sarah Connors, I have to look them up.
It's
one by one.
It's a world building.
He will think logically.
It's a simple world building because nobody knows who anybody looks like because all the records white.
Yeah.
So it's like, okay, how are you going to make sense of the world? And how smart they have to make Terminator. And again, because the timeline of Terminator shifting, this was, 96? So we didn't have an internet.
Yes.
Or at least another mainstream internet.
Yeah.
So the idea of the phone book make perfect sense.
Right.
Good world building question.
I love, in retrospect, the shot, like where we introduced to Sarah Connor, played by Linda Hamilton.
No,
Gunso. Her on the bike.
Yes.
I just hear this kind of like dreamy 80s music.
Yeah, yeah. Pop.
And it's just like, oh, this is the world she's
in. She's innocent and she's naive and everything is established in that one little shot.
Yeah. And look at it now, right? I love just the shot, because she's a waitress, right, at this burger joint. And it's just when she comes in with the food and, you know, the little kid puts the ice cream in her pocket. It's like, I should get you to serve it, you know what I mean? As the last line that her friend says,
this is going to matter.
Yeah, in 100 years, who's going to care?
Yeah. Right?
Love that. Like, just perfect, right, in my opinion. And then we get one of my favorite scenes in the movie, the Alamo gun shop scene.
Yes.
The 12-gauge autoloader.
That's Italian. You can go pump or auto.
The 45 long slide with laser sighting.
It's a brand new. We just got them in. That's a good gun. You just touch the trigger, the beam comes on, and you put the red dot where you want the bullet to go. You can't miss. Anything else?
Phased plasma rifle in the 40-watt range.
Hey, just what you see, pal.
The Uzi 9mm
Know your weapons, buddy. Any one of these is ideal for home defense. So, which will it be?
All.
And you just see how cold and ruthless Detonator is, right? As the man turned around, right? Like, man just pull out a shotgun shell, put it in. It's like, you can't do that.
Decision already made, yeah.
And from an editor perspective, cutting. You can't do that. Wrong. Boom.
Yeah.
And just holds on that shot.
Yeah.
As like, you feel that. Yeah. You feel that chill when you just hear that.
And
boom.
The man is like, oh, cool. You're taking all. Okay, I could close early today. And yeah. It's like, oh, dude, no.
You're probably glad somebody come to his shop to buy shit.
You don't have like built-in credit card slots or something. We don't do the man now.
Yeah.
Yeah, boy. And it just really show how cool-hearted.
A little trivia for Arnie is that he actually learned how to use every single one of those guns.
Nice.
And by the time he was done, he could have stripped a weapon and put it back together blindfolded.
Nice.
That is badass,
And he was commended in some Guns and Ammo magazine back then for being the first action hero to be in a movie that actually handled all the guns accurately.
Okay.
Yeah, a magazine that usually makes fun of actors they would, you know, back then everything is. Good on him.
Yeah. We also get to see Arnold's impatient side. Because there's a scene where he's he breaks inside this car, he steals it, right? And he stops at this this phone booth, right? This guy on the phone comes out and just push him away. And I like when the guy Oscar says,
"Hey man, you got a serious attitude problem."
Like, dog, you just stop here and just push this guy out just because, you know what I mean? I know they made a joke of it with the second one, how he just kind of pushes people away now. And then you just really see in detail, and it's really kind of disturbing what you think about it, though. Just the process of elimination, how the Terminator looks for the Sarah Connor. So, perfect setting up, right? You know, you see the toy truck, you see his car comes, crunches over it, right? So, reminiscent of like how the opening shot is, right? For the movie. And then you see it comes out.
It's like, which tells us something.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Which I didn't pick up until like after the fact, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And then it opens the door, it's like Sarah Connor. Yes. Breaks open the door. And it's slow mo. I love it too. It comes in and she's in fear. Just the way how it's cut the shut.
Yeah.
And then, of course, he just has this tendency of just going. Always like 4 or 5 shots afterwards just to make sure she's dead.
Yeah.
I don't know, like, in Terminator lore, like, okay, like if that was supposed to be the Sarah Connor, what was going to happen then? Was he going to shut down or everything was just going to...
You don't know.
He just kind of does it just because. Right. Like in his head, you're thinking that
maybe
logically
like
he's not going to expect anything to happen.
Okay, so at least at the time of the show, it was a desperate plan Skynet. Skynet was losing and I don't think Skynet planned ahead.
No, because their defense systems had been destroyed by John Connor.
Right.
That's what they said. So basically, it was this or nothing. Yeah, there was no plan.
Right.
And same goes for the humans in the sense that like they realized, okay, crap, they sent one of them back.
Right.
We have to go back too.
Right.
You know?
Gonna go back, right.
Who's going to go back? I volunteer. Right.
Yeah.
That kind of thing.
Yeah.
Right.
So there's no planning ahead. And it's a machine at the end of the day. He's probably going to...
I
will find somewhere to park up myself for... X amount of years. We don't know how long the battery lasts.
Yeah.
Yeah. Last
well, this is something they touch on briefly in Terminator 3 where you talk about the power cell now.
Yeah.
It's like, if I don't have it, I'll just become useless. Like, it don't matter to me what happens. I just do my job and, well, if I die, I die.
But they did say it was the power of, like, a small nuclear reactor,
Right, which he uses to kill. It's like, your Terminator pushed in the inchy mouth. Right. There's a great shot afterwards where Kyle is... dreaming. Well, sorry, just remembering a moment.
Yes. Him in war. That's a beautiful shot.
Yeah, I love how it just always ends where it's also the point where oh shit, what's gonna happen next? And he just wakes up. Yeah. And early on, you see he got the shotgun that he sort of because you know it's the 80s.
I love how that shot fades into the construction site.
Yeah.
You know, the tank, because the same rolling type of tread wheels. Yeah. And
exactly.
So yeah, it's a great shot.
Yeah, I love how he wakes up and just just like that. You know what I mean? Not really so much PTSD, but just like, dude, this is the world he's from. He always have to be ready for anything, right?
Yeah.
So next scene, you're seeing Sarah and your friend getting ready to go out, basically. Props for the Jetson shit that Sarah was rocking.
Well, you forget.
It's like, ha ha ha. At
work, she found out that Sarah Connor died.
Right, so you thought it was serious.
Yeah, so her friend is like, hey, you're dead.
And you're dead, honey.
It's treated as a joke at first, you know?
Yeah, her friend name is Ginger actually, yeah. And you know, as you touch on the whole news reporting,
yeah.
This is where, like, you know, if you kind of look at it carefully, movie technically is a slasher film, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
Think about the time period it came out, you know, at that time, slasher films were big, you know, you have one like probably every, like, more than like five every single month, right? And this is the aesthetic of it. Oh, well, in this case, like, I thought I was going to call him the Sarah Connor killer because he just keeps going after woman named Sarah Connor.
Mm-hmm.
But,
phone book killer or something?
That was it, the phone book killer. That's it, the phone book killer. Right. That's what the cop, well, who you'll see later on, calls, all right? And they even do some slasher tropes. So Ginger is the promiscuous of the two, you know what I mean? You have the boyfriend call up and saying, I'm gonna take off your blouse and I'm gonna take off your bra, you know what I mean? It's slasher shit, right? So the boyfriend's gonna come over and then they're gonna make out and then the killer's gonna come and kill them, right?
That was Nick Cassavetes, right? From Top Gun. Kind of I think so.
And really? I really didn't know who that guy was.
Yeah. Notebook? Directed in Notebook.
Would.
I think that was Nick Cassavetes.
Right. So eventually Sarah goes out and kind of ironic, Kyle is there in the car park, so he just follows after her.
Yeah.
And then she goes to her bar, sees this report, oh shit, Sarah, you know, another Sarah Connor killer is dead. She calls the police.
So she starts to freak out.
We see Lance Henriksen as well.
Yeah.
I love his character too, because like he always trying to, like this smarmy character, that he was cracking some kind of joke and then like the police chief
was
just
kind of
like,
shut him down.
Like, just do it, we don't care. Like, let's stop it, right?
Also considered for the Terminator.
Yes.
And well, Lance, of course, well, he was in Aliens.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, yeah, you know, the Bishop, Bishop, right?
Yeah.
The android. Right. So I have a moment where basically the police tell her, you know, just try to get to a safe place. And then she goes to a club called Tech Noir.
Right.
And even at the time I was like, all right, this on the news, like, okay, it's like you wanna have your own little subgenre.
Yeah.
But Blade Runner was more tech noir than this. This is like
a
tech slasher film. But again, this is a perfect name actually.
Sci-fi horror.
Yeah, yeah.
It's not tech noir. You know? It's not tech noir.
Even the look of it, it's not tech. It's not even noir. It's not even neo noir. You know what I mean? But whatever. It's a great term. Cool, right?
Mm-hmm.
Even play some nice little pop songs. Like it had a song, "Burning It to a Degree." That. I don't know why. I always remember that song. I think it's because of the scene that they set up. But I'll get to that in a bit, right? So while all this is going on, Sarah tries to call Ginger. Ginger making out with her friend, and she actually headphones on. Like, all right.
Yeah, I'm not coming.
Okay, okay, whatever. This was a thing. Listen to your Walkman while I'm having sex. All right, whatever. But in that moment, though, this is where you see just how brutal the Terminator is, boy. Because you take it, he's just gonna ring the bell, whatever it is, and then ask for Sarah Connor. He just barges inside the house. You don't even see what it happens.
Mm.
He attacks the boyfriend first, right?
Yeah.
He just punches at the pillow. Right.
Yes, yeah.
No questions, you know. He just punches it, kills him, and then when he's on the ground bleeding, she tries to run, shoots at her, and then do the usual blah blah blah.
It's a one that he won. I didn't get it too.
Yeah, but I actually like that
one. I didn't think he thought she was Sarah Connor.
He thought she was Sarah Connor.
I think this was like the third or fourth Sarah that he visited for the day.
We're talking about a machine that has no concept of roommates.
Right, just wherever
it
is.
And then it just so happened Sarah called and the voicemail kicks in.
Yes,
he's like,
right.
Wait, no. But,
and this was after he killed Ginger.
Yeah, and this is when it occurs to him, let me find a photo, because they don't care about people.
Right.
So if it had 15 Sarah Connors in that phone directory, he would have killed 14 to get to number 15.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it just, in his frustration, now he's like, okay, no. But I shouldn't say frustration because it's a machine, but he's just like, okay.
Yeah.
I need to know what she looks like because this is getting me nowhere.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But in those moments though, that's where you really see how intimidating, how terrifying this man is as a villain.
Yeah.
Yeah, straight up. I mean, it's kind of old, but he's
but
a really strong villain.
What I love up to that point is that if you know nothing about this movie, this is just a evil guy.
Right.
Yeah, this gunning woman down.
You just know this is like a serial killer from the future.
Right.
You're completely unaware of what is to come.
Right. Now, back to the whole techno thing, right? So, in terms of just tension, editing, pacing, I love the sequence, though, where all three characters collide.
Yeah,
so, you're seeing Arnold first, then you're seeing Kyle just there waiting.
Yeah.
And just how they build it, like
and
in slow motion,
and
like
so
I'll come up with
the
laser sights.
Sarah thinking, Kyle is the cool.
Yeah.
Love that.
Kyle shows up, pulls out the shotgun. Yeah. It just pays so
and I love that little callback where they drag her, because we see where she's clumsy when
yes.
she knocked the guy's coffee cup off.
Ah, yes, yes. And then,
you see this now, she knocks the Canada Dry down.
Right.
So she bends over as he's passing and
right.
he doesn't see her, which gives Kyle enough time to focus in on her. Is this really well set up?
Yeah.
Yeah, I really love that.
Well,
just in terms of peace and intention,
yeah.
it works, right? Of course, Kyle just set up bust some rounds, and then after that, you see the, one of the famous lines
yeah.
that literally every Terminator movie, I can't remember, Salvation did, because Kyle
yeah,
said it then.
Every movie did.
Come
yeah.
with me if you want to live.
Right.
Yeah.
It's kind of funny that in T2, well, Arnold's character says
yeah.
it,
yeah.
but, you know, whatever, that's Terminator
law. Apparently, right? The Terminator is the only character to ever make the best hero and
villain
list.
Yeah, at the same time.
Same
one.
Yeah. The chase sequence that follows, though,
yes.
I think is fantastic.
Mm.
I love the music that. It's so 80s,
yes.
but it fits it
yeah.
so well then, especially because it's all nocturnal, right?
Yeah.
The pacing of it, you know what I mean, just in terms of them escaping in the car,
yeah.
the Terminator running after them,
yeah.
that moment where he jumps on in front of the car and busts his hand, his arm through the windshield,
yeah.
everything just works too. And it really just sets up just how terrifying this guy is.
And then his eyebrows burn off,
yeah.
and then you start to realize, okay, so there's something off about this guy, because
yeah.
then, you know, the
yeah.
hair spikes
yeah.
up.
And imagine just seeing this character for the first time ever, like, without having seen 2 or 3, you see this man clicking shotgun blasts.
Yeah.
He's on the ground.
He
gets up.
He pulls out Mike Myers or Michael Myers.
Yeah.
Yes,
right.
yes,
right.
yes.
Right.
He
sits
up,
he is very
know?
Much Michael Myers.
She's like, what the hell, you know?
Yeah. How he chases after them, kind of in top speed. But there's a moment where he gets in the police car and then he mimics the police officer.
Yes.
That one, you're like, oh.
And you begin to realize
shit.
Now, okay, this is not
okay.
a human being.
Right.
This is
yeah.
something else.
This
yeah.
is scary. This is scary.
Yeah.
You know, if you see for the first time, oh my
yes.
god, this is scary, right?
Right.
So afterwards, though, they have like a little moment where Kyle and Sarah, like in the car park, they can kind of breathe. Kyle could get into exposition mode.
Right.
And, you know, leading up to then, though, I love where he talks about,
listen and understand that Terminator is out there. It can't be bargained with. It can't be reasoned with. It doesn't feel pity or remorse or fear. And it absolutely will not stop ever until you are dead.
I love Michael's intensity
yeah.
here
yeah.
now. Because, like, dude, is like, you don't, like, Sarah does not completely understand
yeah.
what
yeah.
she roped into now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah,
of
he had to get
she,
aggressive.
And
like,
of course, she
right.
would not, because, like, this guy is batshit crazy.
Yeah.
yeah.
You
so,
know?
Like, yeah, he will get aggressive, like, listen to me, you know what I
yeah.
mean? But it works. It
yeah.
totally works, right?
Because I think, like, twice she tries to escape from
yeah, yeah,
the
yeah.
car. And it's valid. That would be my reaction to, I need to get as far away from this guy
yeah.
as possible. But
yeah.
at the same time, you know, there is something chasing me. There is some logic to what he's
right.
saying.
Well,
you know?
He saved her life, so that was declared.
Yes.
Right,
so,
right,
okay,
right.
let me listen
yeah.
to what he has to
yeah.
say.
Because
you're
right
yeah.
up at Lisa B, won't you?
Yeah. Now, little Terminator lore thing. This song that I didn't catch until, like, when I watch it over. And I'm not sure if this is intentional, right?
Mm-hmm.
So when he talks about the nuclear fire, he says that it happens a few years from now.
Yeah.
So because I saw Terminator 2 first, we all know, well then, you know, Terminator, well, Judgment Day happens, I think it's August 30th or something like that, or 29th, 1997, right? So in your head, you're thinking, okay, so 1997 is when Judgment Day happens. But he says a few days from now.
A few years?
Yeah.
A few years, right?
About a decade.
I was thinking, wait, no, but in Terminator 2, it was in 94, 95, whatever period it was. So it's like probably a couple of years from then.
Right.
So is that the idea that with each movie, right, leading up to Genesis,
yeah.
This event will always happen a few years
yeah,
from now unless
back,
it stops, right?
It's got pushed back.
Right. So it's like, oh, okay. So in T1 and T2, it makes sense. But the third one, I remember this, right? I actually remember this, where Arnold says, Sarah was waiting she waited up until that date in 1997
yes.
to see Judgment Day will happen. It didn't. She was suffering from cancer. She died.
Right.
Threw her ashes in the sea, blah, blah, blah. So like, okay, so this is the set date then, 1997.
Right.
But if we take 2003's when it was set, I'm assuming it's 2003. I don't think it's in the near future, right? I could be wrong.
No, then
it just kind of happens like about a week after.
Right.
Mm. Right? So I get like, okay, so it's always supposed to happen like a few months or whatever.
They keep getting pushed back. That is the whole problem.
Right. But here's the problem.
They do a thing and then the government, they never really stop it.
Yeah.
They do a thing and say, okay, they push it back. It was supposed to happen. Yeah.
But Salvation and Genesis keep dropping the whole 1997 thing. Well, right. I can't remember if Genesis really came in and said, it's 1997. This is when it happened. This is what happened.
So but it's like, okay, here's why.
It's a matter of a film breaking its own rules.
Right, yes,
Sarah
Connor Chronicles kind of address a lot of this.
Right.
It's different branching timelines. So it's the wars, it has versions of the wars.
Right.
Some start earlier, some start later.
Right.
But it's different branching timelines.
Some you win, some you lose kind of thing.
All right. But I just always kind of looked at it as, in T3, that's why he says Judgment Day is inevitable.
Right.
Because, it could just happen, tomorrow. If they don't play the cards right. So I kind of like that aspect. But I just think that, in terms of pop culture, think it's 1997. That's when the war begins.
Once you invoke time travel, you have to do that whole branching timeline stuff. That's the only way for it to make sense.
Right.
In any workable way.
So then, of course, Kyle drops the bombshell, where it's like, your unborn son, John, he is going to be the leader of the resistance. He's going to teach us how to destroy these metal motherfuckers, as you call them, and win the war. And then in Genesis, they kind of say that the war was won. And then as a last minute thing, the Skynet sent one of their own to stop things.
Yeah.
And that's where the story really begins, right?
Right.
So that aspect I like about Genesis, actually, in retrospect, that they kind of show what went down, right?
Yeah.
But we'll talk about Kyle's involvement in all this, right? In a bit. But after we get this kind of great shoot, the Terminator comes back again. I love the scene where basically they kind of shoot each other, while in the cars. I thought that was great.
Shows you the intelligence of the Terminator too. Yeah? He chooses to steal a police car, chooses to say his location to see, get feedback on where they are. It's really well played out.
Yeah, but one tiny little nitpick though. I could be wrong with this, right? You have maps basically of LA. So how you know, the police report says, follow this poop over here. Like it's that kind of convenience.
When he was scanning, driving, he constantly does this.
All right.
I think he's scanning and recording everything that's going on around him.
But it's just one of those things that is like a little bit. Like,
It's one of those things you can just debate about. It's just the what knowledge they have of the past and what they know phone books exist.
Right.
They have some data about the LA, what they look like, but not people individually. Well, stuff like that.
So one of those things you just kind of let slide, but
constantly scanning his head never stayed still while he was driving. So.
Oh, and great shot with him with the burned eyebrows. He just keep doing this.
Yeah.
I love that though. I love that, right?
So Arnold actually came up with the look. He had a lot of input in this. Props to him.
See, I remember also is you'll talk about that when he get damaged and you people see.
Well, he got damaged actually with the shootout, right? His eye gets damaged, right? So before all that, the police end up arresting both Sarah and Kyle, take them to the police station, and then we introduced to Dr. Silberman.
Oh, yeah. Horrible man.
I love him in 2. I love how much of a dick he is in 2.
I like him in 2. Yeah. It made sense.
Yeah, but in 3, it's like, we just had to shoehorn him, and that's how they do it. Was just like, him in the graveyard, and you see Arnold come out with the
3 is fan service, and it serves no purpose.
Yeah, it serves no purpose.
But I don't mind if you had him like on television, or something like that, talking some shit.
Yeah, trying to make money off of it, or whatever,
In 1 and 2, he made sense, but then he said, okay, whatever.
Yeah. So, before we get to that, right?
But he was in Genesis, right?
No. Okay. Silberman was in Genesis. Like, he only showed up in the first 3 movies, and that was it. They just kind of not bothered to happen. No, he wasn't there. All right. Can remember, they did do the police stuff, but they do it in 2015.
Okay.
And J.K. Simmons was in there.
He had an arc for some reason.
Yeah, because he was the cop that Kyle met back in 84.
Yeah.
It was just kind of interesting. Like, great ideas, but just... In a tour move, right? Yeah, so Arnold now in this motel, and little minor nitpick again, how you end up in that hotel?
Yeah.
Like, okay, maybe you can make the argument.
Didn't he see through the window?
That's how sick it. Because the window was always closed, because they open. Yeah, so he maybe he just broke in, yeah, killed the person there, and
ran
it there.
Because Indiana does talk about the smell of the
like,
place.
Hey, buddy, you got a dead cat in there?
Yeah, but right. I thought he was referring to the fact that his own human flesh was smelling and melting.
It
was.
Well, it was. It's part of that, too. But I was thinking, like,
because of the damage.
Or maybe he just scanned and it was an empty room. And I don't know.
I don't know. Well, it's just one of those things you just kind of think about, like,
no, it's fine.
Who do?
Yeah. Stuff like that, I don't mind. Yeah. Like, again,
I know, but it's a machine. Like, why would you go to there, like, a hotel? Like,
right.
What do you know about hotels or motels or whatever? Whatever. Moving on, right? So, you get the moment where, what are the graphic moments in it? Where he opens up his arm and he's just seeing like that from this.
This is where we really begin to understand as the audience.
Right.
Holy crap, it's a cyborg. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It's not a demon. Right. It's not an alien because it came from the future. So all this we could be guessing.
Yeah. Right.
It's a cyborg. Right. You know?
And of course, the score for this, the doom, 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 works so perfectly here. Then we get the eye gouging scene,
which
is awesome, but is the subsequent shot where you see him kind of moving about and you see thing in the eyes like that's animatronics.
They built a puppet head, I think.
Yeah.
You could tell because of this whole.
It doesn't hold up well, but
it's too stiff, man.
No, here's the problem again, HD.
A lot of
modern stuff you can tell. You could easily tell.
Because I watched the remastered version of
Me too.
You can easily tell when something is all turned.
And then you could tell with, you see him pick up the shades and put it on.
Yeah.
And then the next cut is Arnold just kind of looking in.
Yes.
I could tell, it's not real Arnold, right? But whatever. But yeah, once again, you know, how he ended up in that room because he had like guns underneath the bed and all kind of shit. Like, okay.
I didn't find him
with yeah. yeah. So back to Dr. Silverman, right? So I love when he's like talking to Kyle. He's asking him all these questions, right?
Mm.
And he dropped this line. When he was talking about, why it is they couldn't kill Sarah? Why it is they going through all this trouble to go to the past to kill Sarah now?
Yeah.
He's like, the files are wiped out, blah blah blah. Mm. And then he make this joke. He's like, so it's kind of like retroactive abortion then.
Yeah.
I see like behind the glass, the cops are just cracking up though.
Yeah.
He's like a real dick though.
The captain was being more serious.
But like, well, you could see how much of a dick Silverman is, but like, I could get why he's like that. Dude, Kyle, like, off his shit.
Yeah,
like,
because
Kyle's
so on edge all the time anyway.
Yeah.
Not helping the matter.
Yes.
He can't come talking calm and making us. Yeah. Can't make sense of it. Yeah.
Yeah. But he does ask a logical question. I have it written down, right? Where he say, why not kill John?
Why not kill John? Yes.
And end the war.
I love that they had an answer for that. Yeah.
Right. And. So,
you're answering the audience's questions.
Yeah,
right?
Why
not just kill John Connor? No.
Right. I can't say it's what they have. Okay.
Quick sign of a grateful.
Yeah.
Every film does do it. Always have a skeptic.
Yes. Mm. Yes.
Superman did it with Lois Lane.
Right.
You know, Avengers kind of did it with Loki. Because he's like, they can't team up. Right. You have to have a skeptic.
Yeah.
You have to cater to that dude in your audience who's
going
to answer these obvious questions. You know that? You're probably not going to answer every question.
Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, so the idea is that,
their defense grid was smashed. We'd won. Taking out Connor then would make no difference. Skynet had to wipe out his entire existence.
Is that when you captured the lab complex and found that, what is it called? The time displacement equipment?
That's right. The Terminator had already gone through. Connor sent me to intercept and they blew the whole place.
Well, how are you supposed to get back?
I can't. Nobody goes home. Nobody else comes through. It's just him and me.
It answers the question about why did you come through naked? Why did it just
nothing dead would go.
Right. So that people have a big problem.
Yeah,
with that, right?
Nothing dead will go. Yeah.
The whole you can't, why don't bring back no weapons of the future?
Yeah.
Yeah. Which he did
and
ask.
How did the liquid metal terminator come through if nothing dead will go?
Well,
that's
a good point. But Sarah Connor Chronicles answers a lot of that.
Okay.
Because they say, no, this is how the sciences work.
But he had the human skin over it, though.
No, but
have
no,
that,
it's all liquid metal.
No. You see, but they address that.
All right, I understand.
Yeah. They address that. Because the thing is, like, I can mimic that to the point.
Okay, so you're fooling the machine into thinking it's
just,
right.
It's just a trick. It's not like the machine intelligence.
Right.
It's just a quirk of physics.
Right.
Right. And what I love too, just in terms of just Freeman, right? The way how Kyle flips out when he's talking about, you know, you don't understand what's going on. You know what I mean? It's very, and you see it copied over in T2 with when he shot with Sarah when she's talking to Silverman.
And that's a great shot, by the way.
Yeah, I love that. I love that, right? So now we get to the iconic scene. Yes, I use the word iconic again. When Arnold steps in. I just love how it happens, though. Yeah. Silverman's about to leave and he just checks his pager. He checks his pager, looks down, and then Arnold walks in. Yeah. And then he talks to you guys like,
I'm a friend of Ciara Khanna. I was told that she's here. Could I see her, please?
No, can't see her. She's making a statement.
Where is she?
Look, it may take a while. I want to wait. There's a bench over there.
I'll be back.
Classic line in the movie, yeah?
They make it work.
And what I love about it is that it's just so simple. It's like, yeah, I'll come back.
So as I'm trying to get there for you. So Arnold thought the line should be, I will be back.
Okay.
Because he was like, why would a robot
do a contraction?
Right.
Unless there's a clear programming thing.
Yeah,
I don't mind that.
Yeah.
Because like Star Trek does talk about that shit all the time. Yeah. Data can't use contractions, but his daughter could have and all that kind of
stuff. So James Cameron answers like, Arnold, I don't tell you how to write my story.
the Adibak works so much better.
Yeah.
There's also a awesome thing comes up. It's so specific. But I checked it, I tested it, and it's true. So the guy said, tells Sarah, the captain, when she didn't want to go to sleep on the couch, you'll be safe here. There are 30 officers in the building.
Yeah.
As we come to this scene now, if you listen to the gunshots going off, it's 30.
About 30.
Wow.
It's 30. It's 30. Brr, brr, Arnold's character. Yeah. Because I started counting it, I was like, holy crap, it's 30.
Yeah. I'm back to you, can I just say, well, you spend enough time amongst humans.
Yes.
That bullshit like that.
Yeah, I guess when James was like, Arnold,
shut up. Just say the line. Okay, I kind of get where Arnold coming from with that, because the I will be back does come across more story.
Yeah.
Like, more robotic. Yeah. Right, exactly. I will be back.
But I prefer the I'll be back. The line just flows better.
Yeah.
Perfect.
But and it's just so darkly comedic because you see that too. Yeah. But it's a shame though that every single other Terminator movie, I'll be back,
even
she'll be back, I'll
work,
be back, he'll be back.
And they do it, but they do it lazy. Because come with me if you want to live works.
Yeah.
The I'll be back.
It's Predator and Get to the Chopper all over again. You know, it's just stop.
Even in Genesis, it's right there like, why, dude? Why?
And even in the trailer, do it too, the dark feet thing.
Right. So, yes. I'll be back. Man, get back to your work.
Yeah.
Man seems coming back. He said it, right? Less than a minute later, this man just comes crashing in with his car, comes out, music kicks in, and he's just gunning down Will Smith.
This is such a great
scene, in my opinion. Yeah. And the funny thing is, like, yes, it's the Terminator gunning down policemen, but it still looks badass, too.
And it establishes what everything Kyle just told them.
Yeah.
This is why he was so freaked out that they're keeping him in one spot for so long.
Yeah.
This is an unstoppable force.
Yeah.
Gotta come good.
I just love how he moves. Yeah, this is how he moves too. Like, Amar will fire two shots. He just uses a shotgun. Boom, one shot. Yeah. I want to see where that guy just flies back though. Yeah.
Might flinch a second if he gets hit, a direct hit. But as Kyle told Sarah earlier, and Sarah asked, could you stop and me say with these weapons, I don't know.
I don't know.
You don't have laser weapons, you know.
I don't feature weapons.
And you take it soon.
I don't know, like, even with modern weapons, unless I had like a 50 caliber sniper rifle.
And you take it too, like, for me, like, from a sound design, every time that shotgun goes off, you just hear that boom, and your heart is just shake a bit though.
Sound mixing.
I just love that in the process, it's not just, we're just gonna glorify, you know, cops being shot. In the process, both Kyle and Sarah managed to escape. So I love that it kind of has a point to it. It's not we're just gonna kill cops and that's fun, right? Yeah. I know it just makes for a great scene.
Yeah.
And this is where I come to my big criticism of all the other films. T3 and the other films, right? James Cameron, right? Say what you want about him. For every action sequence that he does in the first and second one, he always makes sure that it's impactful.
Yes.
It's cool to look at. It's badass, well shot, well lit, music, everything works. And then with the other films, it could never match those movies.
I can't think of a single action sequence in 3, 4, 5 that had a thing. Tree had one okay thing with the truck scene.
The chase, he was cool.
The final fight with him and her.
It's kind of boring. Yeah.
That felt flat.
You didn't feel the weight of it at all.
Yeah, it was just them smashing through cubicles and stuff.
Yeah. And I mean, they missed the point of what does make an escalation. Because you see, it has something called power creep.
Mm.
Right, in storytelling. And characters get stronger and stronger and stronger and stronger. But you have to know how to do your power creep.
Right.
I think power creep, I don't think power creep is truly inevitable or anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
But you have, if it's very difficult to avoid.
Yeah.
Because you always have to top or one up your...
Yeah.
Your previous movie in
some like in anime. Like,
right. Yeah, anime is like, oh god, anime is always happening. Anime is ridiculous. It's always go off.
Like with Black Clover, it's like, okay, how could they become more powerful this week?
Exactly. Right. Yeah. And right, so you had to know to escalate properly. And from one to two was like they make all the right decisions.
Yeah.
Three, two to three, they make
sense. Yeah, yeah, from three onwards. Cause like even the scene where we talk about the police station scene. Yeah. It's just so impactful.
Yeah.
And like no other action scene in 3-4 years
can replicate that. You have to give it weight. Remember I tell you, like, okay, the Fast and Furious franchise, why it is that 6 works for me, but 7 don't work?
Yeah.
Because it's 6, they do again, it's over the top.
Yeah.
But it's within the framework of plausibility that we understand, which is a tank.
Yeah.
Yes.
A tank
yes.
is a realistic thing. We know what a tank is.
Yeah.
But in 7, some magic school bus.
Yeah. Tipping over cliffs. I got it.
It's a boss that has guns. What?
Yeah.
It's silly, but
that's not a thing. That boss is not a thing. Like it might exist somewhere, but that's not a thing. A tank is a thing.
Yeah.
And with this Terminator thing is that it just have one thing that unrealistic.
Yeah.
A goddamn endoskeleton that carries.
Yeah, like Hobbs and Shaw that ending too when they hooked onto each other like that. You can't do that while you're driving.
Yeah, that'll happen. It don't work. And that's why the first and second movie work in that sense. Yes, liquid metal thing is a thing.
Yes.
At the end of the day, you're still using grenade launchers. You still keep it there. And when it's time for that to fight, it only fights with swords and,
and blades.
But you still have a working sense of,
You
know, I don't know what to call it. It's an aesthetic argument.
Yes.
Right? It's a plausibility.
Yeah.
Right? Even though it's not realistic, it have to, why accept this type of realistic versus that type of realism?
Yeah.
You know, that's what it is. Yeah.
Right, so after the shootout, you see Kyle and Sarah underneath the tunnel. You know, they're talking and whatnot. I love those Kyle moments, right?
Yes.
This is where things kind of slow down a bit, which I appreciate. Basically where Kyle just expresses admiration for Sarah. It's like, what I've learned from John, it's like, you're going to grow up, you're going to be a great leader.
And she's rightfully overwhelmed by that.
Yes.
Yeah, the picture of her.
Yes.
Kind of infatuated her. That's the whole thing.
Yeah, which I'll get to.
It's Star Trek, which is your first contact with the guy being totally overwhelmed by you invented war.
He's freaking out. Saffron Cochran.
Yes, you're putting all this stress onto me.
Yeah. Yeah. No, but I like this scene because it's her dream of his description of the future.
Mm.
Yes.
Tough life.
And it's a really, really like sad sequence actually.
Yeah.
But it's how it ends though, where this Terminator actually sneaks into, this,
although I think shelter. It's kind of stupid to have the dogs on the inside of the door and not the outside of the door, but because you have to open the door for the dogs to smell the people that come through the door.
That's true.
So in watching it, I was like,
what? But the thing is, outside is just it's hellscape.
Yeah.
So they had to open the door.
I guess so.
And I actually love how that Terminator just kind of sneaks in, takes off his cloak, and pull out this big ass, like laser gun.
Just
cutting down people.
Mows everybody down.
It's just such a terrifying vision there.
Yeah.
But it's just how they related to her. It's like, I dreamt about, fire and stuff like that, right?
Actually, I heard dogs barking, and that gives us, as you say, that gives us exposition without it feeling like, ooh, my hand was up,
right, exactly.
Oh,
sure, don't
use dogs to tell us.
Yeah.
It's so simple.
Yeah.
Because the next scene, there's a dog in that scene.
Yes.
Now we know.
Right, and then Kyle drops, this message that John gave to him.
Thank you, Sarah, for your courage through the dark years. I can't help you with what you must soon face, except to say that the future is not set. You must be stronger than you imagine you can be. You must survive or I will never exist. That's all.
And this is what I was saying, they did not say there's no fate but what we make. He did say the future's not set, but he just say, thank you for helping me out through the dark days, all that good stuff, right?
Yeah.
And then, we cut back to Arnold now. Arnold's in the motel, and I love this sequence, by the way, where the landlord comes like, hey, buddy, you got that candy? Mm-hmm. Now, back to AVM now and Mosaic Filters. I see this text show up there, so he's like choosing what phrase to say.
Yeah.
So when they reach a fuck you asshole, they blow it out. I just hear, I like, what you say? And even when I saw it on you know, like on sci-fi, it's like, what you say? But then afterwards, it's like, what you say?
Fuck you, asshole.
But how you say it though?
They used to change something. They used to put like, sci-fi would put like, funk you, ice hole, or some nonsense. Yeah.
Monkey fight is next on a Monday to Friday.
Or morbid freakers, like if you've seen Blade. Or the Falcon. Oh gosh. I miss those days, right? I miss those days.
No, you, okay. So you, I think you put up with this ludicrous
movie. Oh, yes, our movie. Yes. The radio version. Yeah. The move.
And it's so well done. It's like, God, this is not working out on the tour.
Oh gosh, but yeah, Arnold's delivery for this is priceless though. I love it. It's a callback to the very beginning, of course, with the punks, right? And then you see just how dark this man is though.
Because he ran out of
ideas on how to get to Sarah.
Yeah.
So he just like a real asshole now, Dredd. He's like, you know what? I'm just gonna go for your mom, Dredd, because I just pick up on, oh, this is where your mom living, Big Bear Cabin. Okay, I'm gonna go there, I'm gonna kill she. And yeah, well, instinctively, I'm going to think, oh, you're going to call my mom. Yeah. All right, cool, well.
Because, I mean, it has a logical sense to it, but it also feels vindictive.
Right. Yeah, boy.
Even though we know he can't.
But it's utilitarianism.
Yes.
You just say, look, I don't do this. I run out of time.
Exactly. Right.
And I just love as far as a shot goes. You just see how it pans. Mm. You see the broken door, where the window it is. You see the fireplace. You hear the music, the doom, 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 doom. I just see Arnold there just sitting on like, love you too.
Yeah.
It says this in Sarah's mother's voice. I was like, jeez, boy. Like, that's some cold-blooded shit, man. Yeah. Come on, right? But, you know, from a tactical perspective, it works,
makes
right?
sense, yeah.
And yeah, and he just does that just to get the address. Just to get the address of where Sarah stayed at, you know?
Genius,
right? The conversation that that Kyle and Sarah have when you're at the motel is sweet. You know, him talking about what she asks, is there someone in your life? It's like, no. Well, you know, I only had feelings for you. Like, I love you, Sarah.
Yeah.
That's why I came through the timeline. No, don't just stop now. Like, it's a beautiful scene. I get it wrong. And then you hear the piano piece, you know,
yeah,
just emotional. Yeah. Yeah. Great,
yeah,
right?
Love Sarah's work. Yeah.
It was actually, strangely enough, the studio insisted that James develop more of the Kyle
relationship.
And James was like, yeah, you know what? Yeah,
it works.
I can do that.
It's a good idea.
It is a good idea.
Yeah. And then, of course, they have sex. But, you know, when you think about it, I was like, okay, so I understand the importance that John had on your life, right, Kyle? So you just figure, okay,
I'm gonna
be your daddy.
Mom.
Right.
All right. Cool. Because I just want to be so impactful. I want my purpose to be so great that I have to go back in time to bring in your mom. Right.
People constantly ask.
That is so important.
No, but
like, what?
You're talking about somebody who has nothing in that world that
he's
from. Fair enough.
But that picture.
That picture.
You spend your days, because we're assuming Kyle was a virgin. You're spending your days with this picture. Because like he said, he didn't even know why John gave him the picture.
Right.
Yeah.
So,
what you kind of explain in Genesis, kind
of.
You're
head of who this woman is. And she becomes.
No, it makes sense.
Yeah.
It makes some sense.
It's obsessive.
Yeah, no, eventually. It is obsessive. An infatuation happens.
Yeah.
Again, you don't understand. People have nothing.
Everything
hungry.
Exactly.
So, I don't have a problem with that. That
yeah.
Makes
sense. So kind of weird, you know what I mean? But still,
I don't think
he
was thinking, this is John Connor's mother and I should not do this. It's just, he's just saying, this is the woman I've been in love with through this photograph all these years.
Right. So, of course, the morning after, Arnold decides to attack. And I like when he comes in and starts to shoot up his day. Well, you know, Kyle and Sarah gone and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, he doesn't even wait. He just opens the door and starts to sprint.
Yeah, then we get another great chase sequence. Mm. You know, Arnold on the bike. Kyle and Sarah, you know, in the van and whatnot. I love the moment where, when Arnold ends up getting off the bike, ends up getting shot or whatever it is. And then he just stops his truck. The truck runs over him.
Yeah.
He comes around and is like, he throws one of the guys out. I think it was a father. So he throws the father out and tells his son, get out. You know what I mean? But, Arnold, he was great. But, Robert Patrick, but he do it much better.
Yeah.
Him in the bike, going up that building, you know, just boosting through
and
then jumping in the helicopter, melting it, and just say, get out.
Yeah.
And the man's like,
Yeah.
Ah! Classic. Classic.
Yeah.
And it's such a great stunt scene too.
Yeah. And it's just no hesitation. Yep.
Yeah. So one thing you see next, you know, the truck that he's in, well, the big kind of gas thing, mm-hmm. ends up exploding.
Gas truck.
Yeah, gas truck, right? I love that moment, actually. It's like, oh, that's what they're spending money on. Big explosion, right? But it's cool. I love, like, the music just kind of calms down. Yeah. And you just see, like Sarah run over to
Kyle. He cast her like this.
Yeah. Yes. And then you take it, oh, phew, movie done. And then that's when you thought Arnold T-101 was scary, but then you get stop motion T-101.
Yeah. Another bit of trivia. The studio wanted to end the movie there. Right. And James Cameron was like,
nope.
Hell no. And he said, even if he had to use his own money, this is not the ending.
Yeah, that
was it. They probably just wanted to be happy. Oh, Kyle survive and I survive. And that's not what this is doing.
Exactly. So. And when you see the actual, like, you know, endoskeleton of it, it looks creepy.
This is where little Summer started having nightmares, because to see it,
it looks creepy enough.
And then
I don't
the stop motion, it does, the way it moves is unreal.
Yeah. And he closes up on the face, and when he's like,
I was just freaked out at this point. It's like, it's not dead.
Yeah. And I think it's because you see his teeth a lot. It's just always like,
It's the skull.
The red eyes, the skull. It's just. Mm-mm. Yeah. But to talk about T2 for a bit, right? So, just that image of the Terminator itself with the exoskeleton is scary.
Yeah.
But I felt like in T2, like in the intro for it, when you see
the fire,
face and zooms in.
Yeah, they get better.
Wow. That scene alone just like chills me. Like, I get chills every time I watch that sequence. But yeah, so he comes in and it's even worse now because now his leg is kind of broken. So he just kind of move it. You know what I mean? Yeah, that sound effect, right? And then they just get that you know, really terrifying moment. They're just breaking inside this factory, trying to escape him. And by that time, you know,
Kyle is
messed
leg,
up. Yeah, he can't really move. And then he just get this powerful moment where Sarah lifts up. Kyle's like, on your feet, soldier, on your feet. You know what I mean? I love that. And it's not shoehorn at all.
Yes.
No. It's just like, no, we need to move it. It's been earned, right? And it's unfortunate that Kyle has to sacrifice his life, you know what I mean, with the explosive that he has, you know, that's blowing up the Terminator
Blowing off its legs
And then you think, that's it. Okay, that's the end. It's like, no, he has no legs. We're still dragging himself
there. More nightmare stuff.
Yeah. And even the music itself is so appropriate. It's just like, my God, this is some nightmare shit here. And then, he drags himself to his point, and then we get to the hydraulic press scene.
Yeah.
I love how you see, like, Sarah, like, reaching for the top button, right? And then she pressed it.
You're
terminated. That's all. Now, when I saw it both on local TV and, you know, WGN and those stations, it'll always be, you're terminated. But later on, it's like,
you're terminated, fucker.
And she just says it fast, like, that's what she said. Oh, presses it. Smashes together, electricity and stuff, and then the arm is left behind, and then
the iconic thing is the red eye.
Where did
they get the brain chip from? In
same thing.
They got it from his head.
They had the hand and they have the chip, right?
They got it from his head.
The head was squashed, but it wasn't destroyed. Just enough to get a salvage. I mean, it's still dead.
Yeah,
just it's squashed. It's a chip. It's still it makes sense.
Yeah, okay.
And that was how Cyberdyne was born, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Speed up the process of the
creation of Cyberdyne.
Right. So he just speed up some things and then slow down.
Yeah.
Right. So one thing that I love about this scene, like overall what I love about this final sequence where she presses the button, is like, if you remember all the other Sarah Connors, as they're about to get shut, you know, they either kind of killing over or like crawling on their knees, right?
Yes.
Before they get shut. She's crawling on her knees to move, you know what I mean? But she doesn't just keep moving just out of fear. She stops and she does something, you know what I mean? So I just love that in terms of just setting up a strong female character.
She shuts the gate down on him and she,
So
she has a plan.
Right. So now we get to the final sequence, which I absolutely love too, because it leaves an open ending. And in this case, it just leaves the possibility of other sequels, which for better or for worse, we kind of didn't need except for two.
Yeah.
But I just love how simple it is, how to the point it is, her in Mexico, her driving, her telling the story to, you know, just all these tapes to Kyle and all that kind of stuff. Which is funny because in Salvation, John didn't even know who Kyle was. Like, he didn't know that, oh shit, Kyle's actually my dad.
Right.
Because they make this thing in one where, sorry, I was saying, you know what I mean? If I tell you about your dad, well, you know, it's all, this is just so confusing.
Yeah.
Which I hate.
But it's like in four, you know, you tell me all these tapes that you make, right? Because a bunch of tapes, right?
Yeah.
You never bothered to say, Kyle is your daddy. This is your dad,
she
right?
She says it, but she doesn't say it. Because she's like, I don't know if I should tell you about your father because I don't know if that will stop you from sending him back.
Right.
She does say that. So that basically is her saying, Kyle Reese is your father.
Right. Yeah, but in 4, though, they could have thought this up a lot smarter. Mm-hmm. They're like, come on, at least one of the two could have said, hey, Kyle's your daddy. That's why you should protect this guy.
She needed to say it, because she said, because then I don't know if you will send him back.
Right.
So
but goes without saying. Imagine Judd going after a guy that he didn't even know going to be his dad.
Because they even like, in 2, don't they show like a flashback scene that kind of hints that John like knew Kyle's importance to traveling back?
I think so.
Something that never make sense of. It's only later.
It always confused people.
It's typical sci-fi when you have a long-running sci-fi franchise. You don't make sense of it.
It just keeps looping back on itself if you're doing that.
Well,
it doesn't make sense.
Also love tonally how it's set up. Like it's somber.
Oh, and little boy takes a picture.
Yeah. Like it's very somber, but at the same time, there's like a little glimpse of hope there, but you know it's like just far off, right?
But we also get, in my opinion, one of the best final girl moments, because this is not somebody shivering in a corner.
Yes.
She has a German Shepherd. She has a gun. She has a plan.
Yeah. Yes. She's going to prepare for this trip.
Which, it has so many other final girl moments that are so bad.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Like, I remember Book of Eli.
I did.
Oh, yes.
I like things about it. I don't love it, but I like things about it.
I like the movie. Movie solid, but that, we tried to do this final girl action.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I was like,
And that was
Megan Fox, I think it was?
No.
There was some other chick. Right. Yeah. No, but she was kind of big, I guess. Yeah. So, the Mexican boy takes a picture and then he makes a deal. And, well, you see the same snapshot that Kyle had, right?
Yeah.
I just love that, the flashback scene where that picture burns and you really see how important it is for him to save Sarah, right? But I love that the very end where the boy says something in Spanish and then where he asks who it is, and then the old guy is like, he says there's a storm coming, and she says, I know.
Yeah.
Puts on the shades, drives off, you hear the music, you see thunder in the back, thunder setting up.
Yep.
And perfect way to end that movie. In part 2, they do tell us what went on in Mexico.
Right.
She went down there to get training. That's awesome.
And stuck up on guns. Just start stacking up guns. So, in short, I mean, not much more I could say about this show. This is a masterpiece, in my opinion. Yep. Yes, I mean, it is a part of pop culture, and for better or for worse, it created this franchise, and we'll see where it's going to lead to with Dark Fate, which I'm kind of worried because is it happening after 2 or is it happening before 3? Does 3 and 4 and 5 count?
I don't know.
As I said,
unless they cater to the spirit of Sarah Connor Chronicles, which is understanding how to make this work and certain other things, unless they do that and start to flesh out some stuff, I don't care. Like if they tell me, oh, you know, we're going to have a Netflix something following this.
Yeah.
I can't see them fitting a good story in that.
Yeah. I don't think James Cameron even likes Netflix. He's one of those naysayers.
He's an old film man.
But I mean, look at it now, it has this kind of like dirty, kind of grungy kind of aesthetic to it.
Yeah.
But I think it works. Because it's an 80s film.
Yeah.
But it just works in just, this is what James Cameron had at the time, right? I just love that he was able, you know, because he got his clout with Aliens and The Abyss, you know, he's able to just kind of give that first film some gloss and hence call it Terminator 2 and just expound on what made the first film so impactful, right?
Yeah.
But yeah, everybody killed it. I mean, Arnold Schwarzenegger became an icon, an action movie, just a movie icon, period,
This was right before Predator.
This was 84, the sky literally was the limit for him.
Yeah,
Linda Hamilton, I wish that her career skyrocketed even more, but it didn't really.
She had Beauty and the Beast.
She had
some mental health issues.
Yeah, no.
Right.
I think it was great that she took the time she needed to get healthy.
She had drama with camera.
Yeah, but for me,
I'm glad she's okay though.
And I'm a fan of James Cameron as well too. I love how ambitious he is with his films. Even though we still waited for Avatar 2, Yeah, it's been 10 years. Well, okay. No Avatar 2.
You wait. I'm not going to say that. You wait.
Look, I know the man's a perfectionist, but still. Tell people, hey, I'm bringing out Avatar sequels.
Not waiting
for I'm not
It had to be some groundbreaking thing, eh? And I don't know, in this day and age, how groundbreaking
I would argue it's virtually impossible for him to come up with something. Why? Because you just don't have the natural advantage of, well, you know, they started to do the anime thing now, which is borrowing from material from before.
Yeah. Right.
Them MCU movies, it's just all of them is just another comic that they're stitching together, right?
Yeah.
I like them, but, you know, that is what they are.
Yeah.
Right.
And, you know, you're most likely DC movies going to be like that. Like, the comic book thing kind of undermining them.
Yeah.
So unless you're a smart sci-fi author, you ain't translating that shit to them. So he had to look for a book fast.
Hmm.
Yeah.
But he can't write the original story. None of them are, the problem is you're writing something original and making it smart is unlikely.
Yeah.
You know, and you gotta look for a book quick. Right. Neil Stevenson, make a Neil Stevenson movie or something.
Right. And, last thing I want to say though, and like, just looking at it from this a storytelling perspective. I don't know, like, if you real into sci-fi or you just want to be like a writer, it's like the kind of shit you wish you came up with.
Yeah.
You wish that you wrote this back in the 80s and forced studios to be like, hey, Cameron, let me make this movie though.
Cameron wish you wrote it.
You know what I mean? Yeah. But yeah, it's one of those shows that you just wish that you could just kind of emulate. Like, you just want to make something so bare bones, but just be able to make it work and then you expand it later on.
Yeah,
so.
Tight. Nice. They just want to make it work tight.
Yeah.
It's a simple story.
Yes.
Exactly. No nonsense.
That's
the point.
It just
loves
it. There's no fat on it.
Very little fat. Little to no fat, I would argue. It works so well. It's just a solid story.
Nothing feels bloated. Doesn't feel wasted. Yeah. It just,
It does feel a little dated at times, which is why I won't give it a 5. But
well,
for me,
I mean, the special effects, but honestly.
Yeah, but for the time, this is what he had, and he made it work the way more than other directors at the time, which is saying a lot.
Yeah.
So, yeah, for me, this gets a strong 4.5 out of 5 for me.
Yeah.
I still have Terminator 2 Judgment Day as 5 because this is the greatest action movie of all time.
Yeah.
That's my story. I stick it to it. And yeah, I mean, if you haven't seen this movie, see what the big deal is.
Yep.
Unless you just genuinely don't like anything sci-fi, action, or violent, then
At this point, who hasn't seen the first Terminator? I ain't sure.
Yeah, who hasn't known anything about it?
Unless you have some youngin'.
I had a weird friend like that, and I was like, listen, go home right now.
Yeah, unless you're some...
Right? And I think, how do you mean you've never seen the first Terminator?
Unless you're some youngin' and you ain't old enough, I can see
you
understand this.
And last thing I like to say about this movie here, before we get to your thoughts, I just love the fact that it was like him, because like James knew his limitations at the time, right? It's just like, I'm not gonna try to make no big Oscar worthy kind of film, I just gotta make something that I really passionate about, something that I really love.
Right.
And look at the franchise that it spawned, look at how impactful it was to our culture, you know what I mean? So that's just testament to just, you know, creativity as a whole. That's why I love this movie here. So if you haven't seen it, do yourself a favor, just watch the movie now. Come on. All right, Ricardo, last thoughts on...
There's a flawless sci-fi film, in my opinion. In terms of, it just again, tight, straightforward. I do prefer it as a film and a story to Terminator 2. All
right, fair enough.
Because Terminator 2 copied a lot
of... Yeah, it's kind of like a rich repeat.
Right.
Like a little...
And you just flip the rules into...
A little bit, right.
Yeah,
but it was... I mean, Terminator 2 is a great sequel.
Yeah.
But it still has the sequel-like problems.
Yeah.
For the most part.
True.
But this, this was just like how to tell a great story. Again, if the ideas at the time was pretty novel, you know... how many people was aware of the time travel stuff? Unless you have Twilight Zone or something like that, you won't be aware of it.
Yeah.
Star Trek was something that wasn't a thing for a lot of people as well.
Yeah.
So it really brought stuff to the popular culture in really intelligent ways. And it's just a solid action film. Just kicked a lot of ass.
It does.
Yeah,
like the movie kicks a lot of ass.
Yeah, I give it like a 9 out of 10. Next to perfect score for me.
Alright, last words and rating on Terminator.
I'm also 9 out of 10 in rewatching this. I haven't seen this in years. In rewatching it for this, I was smiling from opening scene. And I found myself like completely like, you know, normally you'd be on your phone, when I put the phone down, and it's oh my God, I forgot how good this was. And then seeing it as an adult, understanding things you didn't understand before, I had a blast rewatching this. And I think it is one of those movies that you could put it on like maybe every Halloween and say, hey, I'm going to watch the Terminator again this year.
Yeah.
And you're not going to get bored of it.
Mm-hmm. Good thing you said Halloween though. Because this would actually make for good Halloween viewing entertainment.
I also really appreciated the show don't tell aspect of this. I thought that was wonderful because I'm so tired of that in films these days. They act like you're stupid. So it was wonderful to watch a movie. I just imagined myself going into this not knowing anything about it and just learning what I need to learn when I need to learn it,
right?
But seeing what I need to see first.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Totally agree.
So 9 out of 10 for me as well.
Mm-hmm. All right. So that was our take on the Terminator. I really don't know where Dark Fate is
going to. 30th anniversary.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, 35th anniversary. 35th. God damn, we are getting old, right? But yeah, I really don't know where Dark Fate is going to take us.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know these things. I Wikipedia these things, right? Mm. But yeah, I really don't know what we're gonna get with Dark Fate, boy. I really don't know. My expectations are low already, boy. Right. But
I'm going in with super low expectations. But whatever, I'll want to see it.
But my thing is,
I like the interview.
Yeah, but this last thing I just want to say though, is this gonna be like the last we'll ever see of this franchise, or is it just gonna keep going and going and going with this new decade?
I feel like if it would either go to television, I really believe that might be the next medium for it, or they're gonna, the dreaded R word, reboot.
Right.
Which it tried and kind of feel with Genesis, right?
Because of the central plot conceit, you don't need to reboot.
No, you don't. You don't, but this is Hollywood we're talking about.
Exactly. But my attitude is that, as I said, it's not a dead franchise in the water as a premise.
Yeah.
Because unless, let's compare it to Star Wars.
Right.
Mm. Star Wars only have a handful of people that you could work with. Unless if you're not planning to expand the universe, it doesn't really have much to work with, actually, when you think about it.
Yeah.
It's only nerds pile on a bunch of stuff to make it sense. And for better or for worse, somewhere does work, somewhere don't work, right? But this, now, you could play with this so much ways.
Right.
And I don't think it's dead at all.
Yeah.
And it's somebody had to sit down and work with it. And the problem is that they want to just play the old beats now.
Yeah.
That's a mistake.
Yeah.
That's a mistake with 3, it's a mistake with 4, it's a mistake with 5.
Yeah.
They just want to play the old beats, don't really want to do anything interesting. Or if they bring in something new, like in the case of 5, they play in old beats, but at the same time, they don't want to expand upon it in an interesting way, because they have no time.
They want to play on your nostalgia, so they're afraid to go forward too far
and
alienate the past fans.
You don't need to do that.
At the end of the day, what you're doing is you're boring the past fans, and then you're alienating future fans.
Right. So stop wasting time on that. And as I say, Sarah Connor Chronicles is the workable template. Yes. I don't think Sarah Connor Chronicles is a masterpiece show or anything like that. Mm. It was just writers sitting down with the ideas and fleshing it out and making it.
Yeah.
So that is me only to it.
No, last thing I'll say is, and this is my greatest fear with this franchise, I think it's all going to rest on Arnold Schwarzenegger's availability. You know what I mean?
That's a big thing to it. That's the Sarah Connor Chronicles handled it.
Without Arnold, yeah, that is true.
And the thing is, with Dark Fate, they're selling Linda Hamilton.
Right.
She's back. Right. That badass you remember from part 2. So is that going to carry over to a new film? Because I honestly don't think that Arnold needs, if they decide to make a next one, say in 2-3 years, I don't think he needs to be in it at all. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Hell, he doesn't even need to be in Dark Fate, but like he's there because he's there.
You'll always like a callback for his image in some shape or form.
Yeah.
Like, you don't need it.
That's fine. So we'll see.
Anyway, that's me.
Yeah.